on his time. So Dr. Gary Lemme, please come give him a round of hands.
Thank you, Lemme. Good morning, you all. Welcome to the 4-H Center. Hopefully you had a nice time here at the center. The center is part of the extension system. It's funded through primarily the 4-H Foundation. Is there feedback?
Yes.
Yeah, it sounds like I hear myself 3-4 times. I'll talk maybe lower. Does that help? Okay. But we have about 25,000 kids come through the 4-H Center every year. We have the environmental ed program with the Raptor Center. It goes downstairs. Besides that, we have our camps during the year. And then the facility is also open to family reunions, weddings. We had a wedding last night. We have a wedding again this afternoon here at House Street. A lot of corporate retreats during the week, so make sure you take advantage of that. 4-H is up and growing fast in Alabama. About 150,000 kids are involved in 4-H today. We're in 690 school districts. And so, because that's where our future foresters and land stewards are going to come from. And I think it's really important that you be able to make that connection like you are here today. Lee asked me to kind of give you a 30,000-foot view of the role of forestry in the economy of Alabama. And so that's what I'll try to do today. And but I like most of this information is gathered by our extension staff, and you'll be meeting some of them on your speakers today, Dr. Barlow and Andy Burrell, who's one of our field agents. We also have Dean Yannicki Elavanaponte here, and Dr. Adam Margar, the other extension specialist here. So make sure you either talk to them today or give them a call at your local county office. But Alabama is a land of trees. You know, that was especially hard for a boy out of South Dakota, you know, where we use trees for landmarks, you know, except for the Black Hills. And all of a sudden we get, you know, 72% of the state. And it's been really a fun thing for me to learn. And I spent time in Michigan and Minnesota too, so I know what a tree looked like. But you'll have to forgive me for my speech impediment. I haven't been able to lose that one. But about 23 million acres of Alabama is trees. Now these numbers will vary a little bit with the data source that you find. Some will say 70%, say 72%, but we're predominantly trees. You notice we're about an even split between softwood and hardwood. And then, of course, in the middle, there's the mixed. The thing that I find exciting about Alabama's forest lands is you own it. I mean, I was in Alaska all last week working with some colleagues from the University of Alaska Fairbanks. They don't have a logging industry anymore, because all their forest land is public land. They can't cut anything anymore. And so they're logging it. They were importing wood.
Wow.
Yeah. Where in Alabama, because our land is owned by people like you, you can see forest industry companies own only about 6% of that, but most of it is in private ownership. I think we should be proud of that. Looking at commercial land, we're either second or third, depending on which data source you use. Either way, it's a lot of land. And timber is an important part of our economy. And the other thing that's interesting, it's growing. Most states in our country, timberland is going down because of development. In Alabama, we continue to grow. In the last few years, from 2007 to 2012, we gained 200,000 acres of timber. Looking at it a little more specifically, we talked about 23 million acres of timberland. As you can see, most of it's natural regeneration. Now, we have about 7 million acres that are planted, and I know we have vendors in the trade show that will help you get that number up. And they'll like you to stop and look at them. But also, you take a look at, most of our land is natural regeneration, and I think that's important for us to remember when we come to our management discussions this afternoon. Take a look at the production side of timber, the forest products, which are pine needle bedding, you know, for the horticulturalists, and slips and seedlings and things like that, about $112 million, but logging's up about $1 billion. We're predominantly, on the production side, producing logs. but in total was about $1.1 billion. So if we take a look at what kind of products we're harvesting, you can see pine pulp is about over 50%. That's followed with hardwood pulp. So if you take the pulp industry, basically it's 3/4 of the production in our state is going to pulp wood. You can see pine salt, log, timber is about 1/4, and then only about 5% for hardwood. Now if we take a look at that from a dollar value basis, the other one was volume, okay? Now this is taking a look at it on a dollar basis, because we know that certain types of products are more valuable. You notice down in the last slide, poles were only 1% of our total volume produced, but you can see when it comes to value, it jumps up to 3% because poles are more valuable than pulpwood. Even though, and you know, of course right now with the prices of timber products, it's really tough out there, isn't it? But you can see here from a value dollar, pine saw logs account for about 44% of the volume, of the value, excuse me. Pine pulpwood and hardwood pulpwood comes out to about 40% of the value for the state, okay? But it's about $711 million in production. Now if we take and we process that, and it's really important here that we look at how do we add value to timber. Now, if you take a look at this slide and say, holy cow, look at all the slices. Don't worry about the details, okay? Look at the, you notice that down here is the paper mills. They're about $4.9 billion. Paper board mills, cardboard, about $4 billion. Sawmills, about $2 billion. But the important thing is, if you look at all the slices, that's diversity. Unlike some states, where all of their processing is in one. Jeez. You guys must be magnetic. In some states, all the manufacturing is in one industry. The nice thing about Alabama is our manufacturing industry is very, very diverse. And I think that's important. If we take a look at just the top few segments of our manufacturing industry, you can see paper mills, $4.9 billion. But they employ almost 12,000 people. Those are our neighbors, right? They're the people that are going to be helping to stabilize and keep our rural communities vibrant. The neat thing about timber is harvested in every county in Alabama, all 67 counties. We are part of the county economic structure and strength in every county. Take a look at paperboard mills. Another 10,000 jobs, sawmills, about $2 billion, paperboard containers, pulp mills, you see there, about 2,200 jobs, paper bags, wood preservations. But you can see, if you put those all together, that's 55,000 jobs. Those are neighbors in us in Alabama. That's about 10% of our population has jobs because of timber manufacturing. You guys are the job creators for them. If you didn't own that land and you didn't take care of that land and manage it properly, and we weren't harvesting that timber, those people wouldn't have jobs. Those people would not be contributing to our economy. And so you are the job creators. If we take a look at wood manufacturing in Alabama, the number of facilities. There's 36 sawmills. This is 2015. It was the most recent data I could find. Eight, mainly OSB board manufacturers, and then other products. So there's about 48 facilities in the state that are generating wood products. You take a look at the paper product side, there's about 75 different facilities out there. 15, 6, there's, I think this is saying 17 paper mills. I think we lost that one. I think we're at 16 accurately today. But you look, take a look, total there, 123 factories taking your raw product and converting, adding value and being exported out of Alabama. we take a look at that movement that we take from production to processing, look at how important that is. You take here, timber production, it's about, we said, $1.1 billion. That's the raw product, right? And if we didn't process that in the state, that'd be all we would have, right? But because we have an environment that encourages processing in this in our state, the manufacturing side is $17 billion. In other words, for every $1 that we produce from production, $17 are gained from processing. So you take a look at that ratio between manufacturing and processing, about 14.3 to 1. And that shows you the importance of having a public policy environment that encourages and fosters that relationship between production and processing. If we only had processing and all those logs left the state, somebody else would be getting that added value. So we need the two working together. Hunting is also a very, very important part of the forest economy. And you take a look at expenditures by hunters, see about small game, rabbits, quail, not too big here, is it? But deer hunting is the big one, right? That, and I think if you're hooked up with Lee's hunting lease liability insurance program, that's an excellent program. And make sure you have some liability insurance if you're out there leasing out your land. Take a look at the number of hunters, the days that they're hunting. You can see there were 135,000 deer hunters. The thing I thought was surprising is they hunted collectively over 6 million days. I know I'm not getting my fair share. Somebody's getting more than their fair share. If we take a look at what hunting, if it wasn't for your land, the retailers like Academy and all the small shops wouldn't exist, would they? Because people come and hunt in Alabama from other states, and we in Alabama, one of the things that really makes it a great place to live is the hunting opportunities we have. And retail spending, $1.1 billion. That's money spent buying guns, ammo, clothing. Of course, you gotta have the latest call and all that kind of, latest blind and all that sort of thing. You wouldn't want to go to the woods without that, you know. But then you look at the multiplier effect, and even a very conservative number of 1.8 gives you $1.8 billion. Because some of that money turns over in our local economy, right? So then you buy a gun at an outdoor shop that employs somebody, then they go ahead and spend that money on groceries and so forth. You can see wages is about $600,000, 27,000 jobs directly related to hunting. And most of that's in the retail industry. We have a tendency to think of all the guides. That's not a really big number of people, because a lot of, you know, there's a couple people at any one of those outfitters, and they work for just a small part of the year. And so most of them are in the retail. But look at the job, look at the taxes. $104 million in state and local taxes, and $128 million in federal taxes. Now, some of those federal taxes come back to Alabama, to the Department of Conservation and Natural Resources, because they operate their entire program off of the return from the Pickman funds, and Dr. King Alaponic can tell you a little bit about how they use that to support their research programs. But also that's, and then that combined with license fees, there are no state monies in our Department of Conservation. And so your industry, your land is generating a lot of taxes. A couple current topics I think that you want to talk about is right now is the southern bark beetle infestation. Most of this is coming as a result of the drought we had last year. It weakened a lot of our trees. Trees that are weakened are more susceptible to them. And you can see right now it's been identified in 15 counties, about 14,000 acres in 325 locations. But if this spring drought continues like we're starting off right now, this could become very, very serious. And so this summer, make sure you're monitoring your trees, okay? Because what happens is the adult Not an ugly looking thing. Will burrow in, will lay its eggs in underneath the bark. The eggs then hatch. The larvae, they eat along the between the bark and the cambium. They cut off the phloem tubes, and so that you can't get the nutrients moving up and down the trees. And so if you go to those dead trees, you rip off the bark, you'll find all kinds of little channels in there, and that's from the larvae feeding. And then eventually the larvae pop out and fly away and come back and start the process all over. And one thing to look for is when you look at the bark on your trees, look for these little tiny pitch holes. And that's where the adult cuts through the bark and lays her eggs, okay? So look for those when you're out in your timber, okay? And if you see those, talk to somebody, okay? Because you've got trouble on the way. But I think in summary, this is all about optimizing your land. I always tease Lee that instead of landowners association, this ought to be land stewards association. Because that's what you are. I mean, yeah, you're an owner, but you're the steward of that land. You're taking care of God's gift. And thank you for doing that. We want to make sure that owning that land and being a steward of the land has some returns to you. And we make sure that you know what you want to do. Most people who have land today have multiple uses. But you look at any parcel of land, I always like to look at the inventory first. What timber do you have? What water do you have? What wildlife do you have? Those are your three major resources. And then, what do you want? How do you want to optimize those? Is it just for profitability? Or do you want to have multiple use? It involves some hunting, family gatherings, recreation, whatever. That's going to vary for all of you, right? But make sure you know what you want to do. And then set some goals. And there's more than one way to get to that goal. It's like saying, when you left home, I'm going to come to the 4-H Center. Well, there's more than one route you could have taken, right? The important thing is you get to the end, got there, right? The same thing with managing your forests. Set your goals, sit down as a family, and figure out how to get there best for you. And do that by developing a plan. You know, seek advice. We have a wealth of information and resources in Alabama between the Forest Commission and Rick Oates is here, the new forester, state forester. Rick, are you here? There you are, right back there. Stop and make sure you meet him today. We have extension personnel throughout the state. There's lots of private consultants. But get some advice. Get some other ideas. And then control your invasive species. Everything from poking grass to everything else, okay? Because they will destroy not only your resource, but your neighbor's resource. Manage your forest. I encourage you to think about and talk to Rick about treasured forest certification. We've got a very, very strong treasured forest association, and Rick can help you with that. It's a voluntary system, and it's relatively easy to do. It's a matter of knowing what you have and developing a plan to get there. And all you need is 10 acres. You don't have to have thousands of acres. Join your county forestry council. In other words, get active. That's how you get to know your neighbors. You can exchange ideas, look at doing things together. But then lastly, take some kids to the trees. Take them up. We do not want this to be the last generation that went outside. If we let those kids to themselves, they'll just sit there and do this all day long, you know? Take an opportunity to get them out in the woods. Let them go through the experiences that you and I had growing up and learn the love of the land. Because they're going to be the stewards. They're going to be the members of this organization in just a few years. And we need to make sure that they have that same commitment to the stewardship of your land and their land, because it's God's land. And so enjoy your property. Enjoy your day today. And, you know, thank you very much. Thanks for the opportunity to be here. Lee does a great job of representing you at state councils and committees. He's really a good friend to work with. He represents you well. But God bless you all. and war eagle.